Greetings, and welcome to the Provident Vox, where we speak all about the occult and magic, but without the bullshit. You're here with me, Baronessa Aragni.
And me, Baron Aragni. For the past couple of weeks, we've been on a sabbatical, for lack of better words, and now we're back.
That's right, so without further ado, we'll jump right in.
I put a spell on you. Because you're mine.
Today we'll be speaking of the basics of magic, the things you need to know and be able to practice and master before you delve into magic and the occult.
Many people, when they have an interest in magic, they go and do what most people do these days. They go on the internet. No more libraries or anything like that required. So you Google magic or evocation or spell work or whatever, and you come across a blog or a spell or something of the like, and then you think, okay, well, let me practice this. Then, of course, you follow the steps even to the letter, but nothing happens. Nothing happens whatsoever. And then, for some reason, you think maybe magic is bullshit, or maybe you question yourself. But the very reason why you failed is because you just dove right into it.
Remember, listener, practices such as evocation, divination, and spell work is not the whole of magic. It forms part of the occult. So there's a couple of things you'll need to learn before you even delve into spell work.
And that's not even to mention evocation, by the way, which is actually a much higher practice, and it falls under the category of high magic. This is for a very good reason.
Exactly. Now, the thing which makes magic work is energy. Now, this is energy which has been programmed to achieve a goal. Everything is energy. For example, the elements, the planets, however they vary in extent and degree. Each has its own character, its nature, and power, effect.
We cannot make it more simple than that. In order to understand magic, in order to understand any magical practice or paradigm, no matter what it is, magic is energy. Now, without delving a little bit further into the exact energies of magic, as we have written about that in our books, and we might actually make further episodes on this podcast about that, you will need to master the basics of magic, the first of which being energy. You must master energy, or at the very least, understand it, how it works.
Once you understand it, you need to practically apply that which you have learned. It's all good and well if you learn a book, you know, or if you read a book, even our books as a reference, or delve into various books. However, that's not going to teach you the mechanics of energy, how to make it work, and not even to mention your will and intent, which directs the energy towards its goal and then having it manifest the results that you wish to achieve.
As we always say, all knowledge that you may gain through books or even podcasts like this one is just theoretical. That's all it is until you can practically apply what you have learned. Otherwise, it's absolutely useless to you and you will become an armchair practitioner.
Yes, there are many practitioners out there who has podcasts as well, who's written books, but most of these people like the sound of their own voices, and they in fact know absolutely nothing on the subject matter of the occult.
These very same people, if you ask them exactly about the basics of magic, ironically, they will not be able to answer you because they themselves do not even understand this.
Yes, they have a lot of knowledge on, let's just say, demonology or demonolatry, ritual work, evocations, even on demons, angels, jinns, spirits, Olympians, etc. and so forth. Yet they cannot, or they do not have any spiritual power themselves. They are weak and feeble. Thusly, they always rely on something else to do the work for them.
This brings us to the second thing, which is very important. Apart from mastering the basics of magic, such as energy, and understanding how and why everything works in magic, you must build up spiritual power. Spiritual power is not just something that is what bestowed on you. There's no such thing. Spiritual power is something that you gain through hard work, effort, practical experience. Spiritual power, in turn, goes hand in hand with spiritual ascension, which should be everyone's ultimate goal. And also spiritual authority. Spiritual authority is something which plays a very large role if you work with spirits, intelligences, demons, angels, jinn, celestials, whatever you have.
You can only direct them, those sentient, intelligent beings, if you have enough spiritual authority. Because remember, these entities have no cause or reason to obey your commands, irrelevant of what words of power you use. Remember, the words of power you use in certain rites and rituals is directed by your spiritual authority and turn spiritual power.
So you can perform the ritual to the letter and you can yell out as many words of power as you wish until you go blue in the face. At the end of the day, most likely, and especially if the being you seek to work with is more of a necromantic or infernal nature, they would literally just look at you and think to themselves, who the fuck is this asshole?
Exactly. So a lot of training goes in hand with that as well. Training yourself, your faculties, your soul, your being, strengthening that. So your authority is higher than that of the spirit you wish to command.
That is ironically something which most people in the modern occult community does not seem to understand. Whatever you seek to control or employ or whatever it is, your spiritual authority must exceed that which it has. This also goes with people. If you want to perform a spell work on someone, say you want to curse someone or you want to manipulate them or whatever it is, if your spiritual authority, if your spiritual power, if your will does not exceed theirs, is not greater than theirs, then it doesn't matter what spell you use. It's just not going to work.
Exactly. So we've already covered that you have to do some hard work and to achieve spiritual power. And it is not an impossible feat because we've achieved it and so has a few others. So you can do it very well. You just need determination and a strong will in order to do that, as with everything else in life.
And let's not forget dedication. You see, if you're serious about practicing magic, it's not something you can dive in for a weekend or to do it with your friends or you do it until you have a failure or do it for thrills. No, then you are called a dabbler. And dabblers, yeah, we fucking hate dabblers.
Exactly. So do not be classed as such. If you want to be a serious occultist, you have to put in the work. Because no spirit or entity is going to do that which you need to achieve yourself. So you have to do that yourself. No one and nothing else will be able to do that for you or grant that for you, irrelevant of who says what.
Many people also delve into the occult world. They think it's going to be easy. Let us tell you right now, and we cannot make it any more clear than we are about to right now. Magic may be the most natural thing in this world you can possibly think. It's not the supernatural, no. It is part of everything. But to learn how to master that, to control that, to harness that, to direct that, that will take a lot of your time and dedication in order to do.
In regards to that, you have to practice and you have to practice perfect. And remember, failure is not failure. It is experience. And that is how you learn.
This also means that if you have family or a spouse or children or work or school or whatever it is that is part of your life right now, if you are serious about magic, you cannot just say take a half an hour a month to practice magic and then complain after a while that you're not getting anywhere. No, magic must become a part of your life. It must become a part of you. We're not saying to cut out the rest of your life just to practice magic, no. But this is where dedication comes in. If you really want to master magic, you are going to have to work for it. And that means making the time to practice, to train yourself, to learn things.
You must have the correct mindset. In other words, you need to set yourself aside for yourself for the purpose of practicing magic. And in that moment of time when you practice magic, nothing and no one else exists. It's irrelevant whether you are a solitary practitioner or whether you work in a coven or work with a coven, a house, a lodge or a cabal. That is irrelevant.
Amongst a couple of other things that you must be able to understand properly is one of time and distance.
Time in magic does not exist, nor does distance. In other words, time and distance is not going to hinder a magical operation.
For many people, this is very difficult because obviously in the mundane world, time and distance does play a very large factor in things. But consider this, magic is wholly spiritual, all right? So in the spiritual world or in the non-physical world, the energetic world, whatever else you want to call it, the same things that hold sway over the physical world is no longer in play, which means if you want to, say, cast a spell on someone who is on the opposite side of the world from you, that's not going to be more difficult, or it's not going to take longer to manifest, or whatever you may think, because distance does not exist.
The only thing that might affect it, or actually will affect it, is your level of spiritual power in performing that magic.
Actually, the other thing that will also affect it, apart from that, is energy. Again, negative residual energy, different blockages and stuff like that. But that, we believe, can actually form a part of another podcast and not this one.
Yeah, I agree.
Now, time. We can actually use a most excellent example of this. We advise people, if they want to evoke something, or if they want to employ a spirit or whatever, that they should refrain from mentioning a time frame to the spirit. As in, they should not say, okay, so-and-so do this and that within 7 days. It will likely not work out. And the reason for this is pretty simple. This world of the spirit, or the spirit world, has no time. They do not have days, weeks, months, years. A second can pass, or what feels like a second on their side, it is a week on our side in the physical.
Just remember that the laws of magic does exist, and that is where the hermetic laws comes into play as well. As well as the world of the ether or the world of the spirit have its own set of laws and rules, for lack of better words. So what affects us in the physical will not affect the spiritual in the least.
However, what happens in the spiritual easily affects the physical. That is something actually very interesting that we can also say in this, just a little bit of a tidbit here and there. The spirit does not need the body in order to exist, but the body needs the spirit. Likewise with anything else. If something is changed in the spirit world, so it will reflect with its physical counterpart. To put this into a little bit of perspective for you, if you, say, curse a person, you are not physically cursing the person, or the energy is not somehow going to cause changes directly on the physical form of the person. No. The energy affects the spiritual counterpart of the person, the soul, the ether of the person, which then in turn reflects on the physical of the person. Are you following us?
Yeah, the physical of the person and the microcosm as well.
This actually should also give you a bit of a hint of how the spirits of the dead can influence things in this world in regarding switching things on and off, moving furniture about, and so on. Something else that any aspiring occultist must know is ritual layouts and ritual discipline. Now, for many people, this can be very taxing. And indeed, it is actually very taxing. But there's a reason for this. Those rituals that you would see laid out in especially older grimoires, opening the ritual, the body of the ritual, the end of the ritual, all the recitations and circumambulations and fumigations and recitations and what have you. As taxing as it may be to learn and to perform, As a beginner, as a neophyte in magic, it is very important actually for you to go through those motions, because by doing so, you learn what a ritual consists of. You learn how, or the basics actually, from that you can build up your own rituals later on when you become more experienced. It also teaches you the discipline. The discipline so that you cannot just jump into a ritual whenever you want and wing it. If you are experienced, that is exactly what you can do. You can start a ritual whenever you want, on a whim you can do that. And you can also formulate rituals on the go because you have the experience and the knowledge to back that up. But as a beginner, you should never try to just wing it during a ritual or spell or evocation or anything of the like.
Speaking of rituals, you also get ritual tools. We want you to remember the following, that the ritual tools is not magical by itself, but only becomes magical once you imbue it with magic through your will and intent. Tools such as the athame, the bowline, the sword, the wand, the pentacle, and much, much more. All of those implements are not magical by themselves.
By themselves, it is just, I don't know, a dagger, a stick, a bell, whatever it may be. That's exactly what it is. It's mundane. There's nothing special about it. A most excellent comparison that we have made some years ago is, take the shovel of a grave digger. Is it magical because it digs graves for the dead? No, it is a shovel. Nothing more, nothing less.
And another thing that comes into play is association. With every part of magic, if you cannot associate with the form, the structure, or the implements, do not make use of it.
This is something that many people struggle with. If you want to practice a certain paradigm, yet you cannot associate with a thing, then people still try to go through the motions and they burn themselves out trying to practice that. But they cannot associate with it at all, and then they wonder why they get nowhere.
Exactly. You need to associate with it in order to make the best of it. Same with everything else in life.
Well, we believe that concludes this particular episode. We will most likely make a follow-up to this one in the future, because there's actually a lot of things that we can speak about in beginning your journey in the magical arts. However, we will cut it right here.
Thank you for listening.
Find us on Facebook, YouTube, Spreaker. We're on so many platforms, it's very hard to remember all of them. But you can find us on many different podcast platforms. Please subscribe, please like, please share. And always remember, as above, so below.
As within, so without.